There's a kind of hush all over the world.
All over the world.
Good to see you here, all of you here this morning, on this rather chilly morning.
Morning.
It's a morning to stay in bed, isn't it? That's what I've got like. Our bedroom's rather cold, so yeah, don't want to get in. But here we are, in the house of the Lord, here to praise Him and to worship Him and to to meet with Him. Is that your expectation today?
Amen.
Yes.
Thank you. Anyway, this morning you've got Jen and I. As most of you would know, Eric's got COVID and Sandy's been affected with a cold, whatever. But this morning they're feeling much better and sort of over the worst of it, praise the Lord. So just remember them in prayer, lift them up before the Lord. The other one we need to remember this morning when we pray is Tanya is in hospital, went in last night, or yesterday afternoon last night. Her blood's too thick, they were concerned about her having a stroke, so they're busy dealing with that this morning. And unfortunately this morning they wanted to take her for a CT scan. When they were trying to find a vein, they obviously got it in and then the vein burst. They had to take her back to the ward, but praise the Lord, they found another vein and we're just trusting that that will keep to enable her to have the test to be done. So, those are two that need prayer. And anybody else? Yes, Don?
I just got a voice call on my phone now from my brother-in-law, Yalpi Duplessis. He's very emotional because his one daughter immigrated to New Zealand and the grandchild. Now the other one's also going. And he's just in a devastating way. So just if we can lift him up in prayer, that the Lord will make him strong. You know, he does suffer a bit from depression. Mm-hmm. So please, if you
could
just think of him.
So that's Yalpi as well. Really for peace. Oh, no. For peace in the circumstance. Know what it feels like too. And Pushpa also hasn't been well. She's been to see the doctor and so on. She has an infection. Although we just spoke to her, I mean, she's, you know Pushpa. She's always up somehow. Always trusting the Lord. The Lord can do anything. So, okay, let's just open in prayer then straight away. And Ken, can I ask you to pray for all of them, including Yalpi, for peace? Thanks. Well, there's Eric and Sandy and Pushpa and Tanya and Yalpi. But the Lord knows. Thank you.
Glory to the name of Him who sits upon the throne this morning,
yes,
and who reigns supreme over all. Lord, many names have been brought before You this morning. People that are not well, people that we know, those that we don't know, Lord. And I can't remember them all, but Lord, they're all known to You. Who else can we come to but to the great healer?
Amen.
Your word tells us there's healing in our wings and by thy stripes we are healed, Lord.
Amen.
We serve a living God. A God who is not deaf. A God who has not been carved out from wood. But a God who is God over all.
Amen.
And to whom nothing is impossible.
Amen.
We bring them to You, Lord, because we have faith. Believing this morning that as we ask, so You will do, Lord. Therefore we ask that our prayers will come before You as a sweet incense to Thy nostrils, Lord, and that we will find favor before Thee this morning as we lift these names up before you, Lord. I think it's Yapi. We know our brother Eric and his wife's hand is not well.
Amen.
Our sister Pushka, can't remember her name.
Pushka.
Pushka. And then our sister Tanya as well.
Yes, Lord.
And there's many others, Lord. Our brother Rassi, our sister Frida, and there's many others, Lord, that we want to bring before you this morning. And we ask this morning in your precious name, in that precious name of Jesus, that you would touch them, all, Lord. Heal, set free, deliver this morning, Lord, and bring peace, I pray, to those who are in need, Lord, of whatever touch from your hand. Because your heart is full of compassion, full of mercy and grace. We know, Lord, that you hear our prayer this morning, and it will be done according to thy law. So bless thy name this morning, Lord, we pray, and we glorify your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Amen. Victoria in Rhodesia. Just close that door, please. Thanks. It was myself and two others that formed a singing group in our church, and we used to play together, and I remember we bought identical shirts. Nobody knew that. And my beloved made ties of the same material. And we stood up in church like that to sing, and had a nice reaction from that. But in those days then as well, we one of our a pastor that we had was very much an evangelist, so we had some evangelical meetings in the town hall, and it was fun. God was good, and yeah, what an experience. It just reminds me of that. We didn't have a pianist then, but I remember we imported a drummer to help us as well. I know who holds tomorrow. Do you?
Yes.
Let's stand.
I don't know. I don't know.
Anything, my God can do anything.
could sing, just from the few of us. We're a good choir, eh? God is good. Amen. Anybody like to share anything this morning? Got a bit of time? John, I'll come down to you.
Stay there. Eddie? It's fine.
This morning I want to say a very difficult promise to pray. You know, we sometimes think we're doing the right thing, but we don't really ask God. So when it comes to certain things in our lives, God says, ask me and I will guide you and I will look after you. Something happened last night. My cell phone just packed up after many years, to be honest. And I thought, it's an old thing, you know, like certain things. And I put it on to charge almost all night. And this morning I asked Ella to bring it to me, and there's nothing. There was absolutely nothing. So eventually I just took it and I threw it on a bed there, and I just said, lie there, you useless thing. They didn't call you a cell phone useless. After a while, I thought, no. I put my hands on it and I said, Lord, in the name of Jesus, please help me. Please, Lord, we haven't got the money to go buy another one. Let's just go for it. The first thing that came up suddenly is, there says, put in a password. And I thought, sheesh, I haven't had a password for years. So I put in 5 9s and a 0, and it says, not applicable. I thought, uh-oh. So I put in again 5 9s and a 0, not applicable. And I thought, oh boy, how many zeros and nines are there in the world? So I put in 5 zeros again, and when I pressed the button, it came up. Wow. Well, I just praise God this morning, brothers and sisters. Amen. He looks after every little thing. Please, if your car breaks, if anything, God is there. It's funny, so I played a trick on Della because she knew the thing was broken. So I rang her. She answered, I said to her, how are you? She said, no, fine. That didn't work. I said, are you going to church this morning? I said, yeah. I said, well, can I come with you? She said, yeah, sure, okay. And put the phone down, afterwards she came to me and she said to me, I said to her, did you speak on your cell phone? She said, yes. I said, well, I phoned you. She said, oh, really? What happened? I didn't realize that it worked. We laugh, brothers and sisters, because it's fun serving a great God.
Amen.
It's fun.
Yes.
And he also said to me to say that we mustn't listen to the news or to false prophets, please. To just listen to anything that comes up. But follow what the Word of God says. Yes. And then from there, go to the book of Revelation and just try and follow what that says and what the Holy Spirit teaches us. What the Holy teaches us this morning is God's message to us. What the Holy Spirit teaches us, that is God's message to us this morning.
Amen.
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 Before Graham died, I
said, Tim, what am I going to do? Where am I going to go? How am I going to manage? And he just took my hand and he said, God will make a way. And he did.
Wow.
He provided a new home for me, a lovely community. He sold my house for the price that I needed to buy the new one. And I want to thank him for his faithfulness.
Amen.
He is such a faithful God. Amen. When we don't know the way and we can't see the way, just remember that he's already been that way.
Yeah.
And so he will lead the way for us and open that way. And I just wanted to thank God. It's such a beautiful little place. And the people are so kind and have made me so welcome. And I bless God for that. He is so very, very precious.
Amen.
It's good morning to everybody.
Morning.
It's the same, it's true what Adrian says. Willie and I, in the early 90s, we were going home, and you know, in the early 90s, we were about 91 or so. We traveled back to Alberton. We were living on a small holding, and just at Alexandra, our car just cut out. Completely, no lights, no nothing, it just died. We came back from a prayer meeting, I think, and it was pitch dark. And yeah, we were sitting almost in the middle of Alexandra, and we decided, no, we're going to pray over this car. So we prayed, and we started it, and there we went. The following day, I couldn't get the car started. So I phoned a friend of mine that works on my company vehicles. And I asked him, I said, Tony, please, I says, come out here to my place. Something wrong with my car, and I explained to him what happened. And so he came there with a breakdown truck, took my car away, phoned me later on. He said, Ken, where did you break down? So I told him. He said, no, it's impossible. He says, it's impossible. He says, your alternator is backed up. He says, no ways could you have started that car. Everything was dead. It couldn't happen. So I'm goosey as I stand here and I'm telling you, because we're serving a living God. You know, there's those little things that makes your faith grow stronger and stronger. All those little kind of things. And we've all experienced these little things, and we never stand up and give God the glory for it. We think, oh, well, it's just another thing, you know, as breathing. Just a normal thing. Thank you, Lord, for it. But that's a blessing that He gives to us.
Thank you
so much.
Those of us who've been in Rhodesia, remember Andre and Fruchendeber?
Yes.
The few of us who knew. And when she was ironing and her iron packed up, and she laid hands on the iron and said, Lord, just until I finish the ironing. The iron came on. Until she finished the ironing, and then it died. I remember Pastor D said to her, you should have prayed that it be fixed permanently. Yeah. We'll take up the offering now. I think I'll ask. I'll ask my beloved. Do you mind? Okay.
Doesn't have any options.
Thank you.
does. Praise God. Okay, now let's sit back and give thanks.
Lord, thank you. Thank you for taking care of us.
Thank you, Lord.
In the little things and the big things, in everything. We're so grateful to you. Thank you, Lord, for the offering. We ask you to use it to the extension of your kingdom. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Right, we're going to sing a hymn, number 304. Sound the gospel of grace support. Because there's life in the risen Lord. Share together this morning
that your word would bring blessing to our hearts.
Thank you.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 Thank you. I'd like you to turn to Psalm 125. Psalm 125.
125.
They that trust in the Lord shall be as Mount Zion, which cannot be removed, but abideth forever. As the mountains are round about Jerusalem, so the Lord is round about his people, from henceforth, even forever. For the rod of the wicked shall not rest upon the lot of the righteous, lest the righteous put forth their hands unto iniquity. Do good, O Lord, unto those that be good, and to them that are upright in their hearts. As for such as turn aside unto their crooked ways, the Lord shall lead them forth with the workers of iniquity, but peace shall be upon Israel.
Amen.
I love flying. Not particularly shared by my beloved, but I love it. When I started work, 1964, that's what, 58 years ago, a long time. I worked for the meteorological department, the weather department, and in Rhodesia, and was stationed in Bulawayo at the airport, and there I, was accustomed to the aircraft coming and going, to the pilots coming in for their weather forecasts and so on, and of course watching the planes and so on, being there, I just love the plane. So I was transferred to Salisbury Airport and worked there. And then during my time there, after we got married, I was appointed to as a member of the cloud seeding team. Now, cloud seeding in those days was experimental. You see if you can seed a cloud and make it rain more. It's a farmer's luck, We had a farmer who used to phone every day into the forecast office, is it going to rain over my farm? And the poor old forecaster would have to try and tell him, well, we can't control that. But we flew in a Air Force Dakota, a DC-3, which had been converted, and we'd take off when conditions were right and fly, climb to 10,000 feet above ground. So we had to be on oxygen. But I loved it. You fly above those clouds, and sometimes you'd have a cloud base, and all the cumulus clouds, the cumulus congestus clouds, we call it when they're really big, poked up through like mountains out of in the sky. It was really wonderful. And we fly through, it was cold. But when you chose a cloud, we're going to seed this one. We dive down fast down to the bottom of the clouds. Exhilarating. Loved it. Loved it. Then I was transferred to Fort Victoria, Mazwego now, and running the airport there. And then I was in my element. Then we've got the commercial aircraft coming and going, the light aircraft. Sometimes a military aircraft would come through. I remember once a jet was coming through, one of the vampires. And I said to him, can you do a meet-up of the airfield? He said, sure. And he came low across the airfield. What a feeling.
But the poor old firemen that were there, the fire crew, they just got fed out of their vehicles. But those were the things that I loved. And there was a man there who owned the hotel, and he had a little aircraft called a Citabria, which is an aerobatic aircraft. So Citabria is aerobatic backwards. And he one day he came out and said, "I'm going to have a look at the golf." And he said, "Would you like to come?" I said, "Sure." Told Joel, jumped into the aircraft. It was like a fabric thing. Off we went. Check the golf. And I flew once with our doctor, our local doctor. He was doing some clinics in a session of 172. Also loved the flying. Down here, I flew a couple of times to Cape Town on business. And the one time I flew, I was allowed up into the flight deck. Those were the days, eh? And sat on the flight deck as we approached Cape Town. And you fly over those mountains. It's just an incredible, incredible view. And such a blessing. And that same flight, when I remember when we were returning, it was evening, and pulled out over False Bay and headed inland over the mountains towards Worcester. And the clouds were spilling over them, but kind of staying in place. Do you know what they're like? They don't just disappear. The sun being quite low, the mountains were so clearly defined. With their jagged edges, the ridges were clearly defined, the shadows gave a feeling of permanence, that they were impregnable. I could look down at the tops, some quite pointy, others flat, which I guess one couldn't see that from a ground level. And you know, I thought about Moses standing on the mountain. Did God really look down on this little man, so insignificant, so small in this vast mountain? And of course he did. And he came down to speak to him. Wow. Now I got to thinking about mountains mentioned in the Bible. I wonder if you've thought about them. The mountains of Ararat, on which the ark came to rest. Jacob, in fleeing from Laban, he went to Mount Gilead. Esau, he dwelt at Mount Seir, if that's how you pronounce it. Joshua built an altar unto the Lord God of Israel in Mount Ebal. And that mountain was some 2,700 feet high, that you see in Joshua 8, verse 30. Mount Gerizim was mentioned as a mount of blessing in Deuteronomy 11. Mount Tabor, which rises at about 1,843 feet. I like the old things. I can picture that. I can't picture meters. Anyway, Mount Tabor rising out of the plain of Jezreel, and it had an idolatrous shrine on it in Hosea's day, and later a town on its summit, even in New Testament days. What about Jesus? He preached probably his most well-known sermon on a mountain, Matthew 5. And where did he go to pray? Up into a mountain. But today, I'd like to look at just a few specific ones. Firstly, Mount Sinai, also known as Horeb. In Exodus 3, we read that Moses, keeping his flock of sheep, came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And that was where God first spoke to him and commissioned him. At a mountain. We find that when the Israelites left Egypt, they camped at the Mount of God. And it was there that Moses went up into the mountain to receive the Ten Commandments. It was also at that same mountain that the children of Israel stripped themselves of the ornaments by the Mount Horeb as a token of repentance for their sin. And you can read about that in Exodus 33, verse 6. And where did Elijah flee after Jezebel vowed to take his life? Horeb, the Mount of God. And that's where, as he stood in the cave, there was the wind, there was the earthquake, there was the fire, but where was God? A still, small voice that spoke to him. And I wonder sometimes if we are in a problem, we're looking for that wind, we're looking for that fire, we're looking for those earthquakes, but we need to listen to the still, small voice of God. How about Mount Moriah? In Genesis 22, God said, and he said, take now your son, this is what he said, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah, and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains, of which I shall tell you. And we know the story, eh? The 3-day journey to get there, Isaac asking where the lamb was for the sacrifice, and Abraham's answer, my son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering, foreshadowing the Lamb of God, the Lord Jesus Christ. But I wonder, did you notice that on this occasion, it wasn't a lamb that God provided? Have you thought about that? But it was a ram. A ram was used for a peace offering when Moses was consecrating Aaron and his sons. If you read about that in Exodus. Interesting, huh? God will provide himself a lamb. But in that occasion, he provided a ram. Then I found something interesting. In 1 Chronicles 21, this is what's written. Therefore, the angel of the Lord commanded Gad to say to David, that David should go and erect an altar to the Lord on the threshing floor of Ornan the Jebusite. So David went up at the word of God. He went up at God's direction, the word of Gad, sorry, which he had spoken in the name of the Lord. Now Ornan turned and saw the angel, and his four sons who were with him hid themselves, but Ornan continued threshing wheat. So David came to Ornan, and Ornan looked and saw David. And he went out from the threshing floor and bowed before David with his face to the ground. And David said to Ornan, grant me the place of the threshing floor, that I may build an altar on it to the Lord. You shall grant it to me at the full price, that the plague may be withdrawn from the people. But Ornan said to David, take it to yourself, and let my lord the king do what is good in his eyes. Look, I also give you the oxen for burnt offerings, the threshing implements for wood, and the wheat for the grain offering. I give it all. What a gracious heart he had. Then King David said to Ornan, no, but I will surely buy it for the full price, for I will not take what is yours for the Lord, nor offer burnt offerings but that which costs me nothing. So David gave Ornan 600 shekels of gold by weight for the place. And David built there an altar to the Lord, and offered burnt offerings and peace offerings, and called on the Lord, and he answered him from heaven by fire on the altar of burnt offering. And then in 2 Chronicles chapter 3, we read that Solomon began to build the house of the Lord in Jerusalem. And it says this from verse 1. Now Solomon began to build the house of the Lord in Jerusalem on Mount Moriah, where the Lord had appeared to his father David, at the place that David had prepared on the threshing floor of Ornan, the Jebusite. So where Abraham was, and he was in the land of the Philistines at the time, that God told him to sacrifice Isaac. And that's about 80 kilometers from Jerusalem, something like 3 days' journey. We also know that the land of Moriah means all the mountains of Jerusalem. So there's little doubt that Abraham's sacrifice took place on one of the mountains there, on the Temple Mount itself. Wow. How exact is God? Mount Zion. This was first mentioned in Scripture in 2 Samuel chapter 5, where David took the stronghold of Zion, and the writer comments, the same is the city of David. King David brought the ark up to Zion, the city of David, and the mountain became sacred as a result. Isaiah records that the Lord of hosts, which dwelleth in Mount Zion, Isaiah 8:18. And he also says in chapter 4, verse 5, Isaiah says this, and this is in the Amplified version. And the Lord will create over the whole site, over every dwelling place of Mount Zion, and over her assemblies, a cloud and smoke by day, and the shining of a flaming fire by night. But over all the glory shall be a canopy, a defense of divine love and protection. And there shall be a pavilion for shade in the daytime from the heat, and for a place of refuge and a shelter from storm and from rain. Imagine that. And even today, I believe that the Lord covers over Zion, covers over Jerusalem, protects his people. When Solomon completed the temple at Mount Moriah, he brought the ark there. And so the name Zion extended to cover the city of Jerusalem as well. Now here's another little mount, the Mount of Olives. What's so special about this mount? Well, physically it's a ridge about 2 kilometers long, and it has four summits on the slopes of Bethany, Bethphage, and Gethsemane. When Absalom was doing his best to capture the hearts of the people and turn them against King David, David had fled from Jerusalem, but instructed Zadok the priest and Abiathar to carry the ark back to Jerusalem. And then we read this. David went up by the ascent of Mount Olivet and wept as he went up, and had his head covered, and he went barefoot. And all the people that was with him covered every man his head, and they went up weeping as they went. It was a place of mourning, a place of prayer for David. And when the Lord Jesus made his entry into Jerusalem, it was from Bethphage on the Mount of Olives that he sent the disciples to collect the ash for him to ride on. See the connection? It seems that he went there often, because John says in chapter 8, verse 1, Jesus went to the Mount of Olives, and early in the morning he came again into the temple. And Luke also mentions that he went there as usual, so it must have been a special place of prayer for him. When he spoke to his disciples about the end times, as you see reported in Matthew 24, it was while sitting on the Mount of Olives. And after the Last Supper, when they sung a hymn, they went out into the Mount of Olives. And it was here that Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane, saying to the three disciples with him, "My soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here and watch with me." Much the same as what David did, eh? Climbing up Olive, the Mount of Olives. He certainly was son of David. Finally, in the first chapter of Acts, after Jesus ascended to heaven in the presence of his disciples, it says this. Then returned they unto Jerusalem from the mount which is called Olivet, which is from Jerusalem a Sabbath day's journey, which is about 2 kilometers, which means that he must have ascended from the Mount of Olives, the same place to which he will return. And his feet shall stand in that day upon the Mount of Olives, which is before Jerusalem on the east. And the Mount of Olives shall cleave in the midst thereof toward the east and toward the west. And there shall be a very great cloud, and half of the mountain shall remove toward the north, and half of it toward the south. The triumphant return of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. As he lands on Mount Olivet.
Amen.
Another mountain that has great significance, although it's not named as such, is commonly called the Mount of Transfiguration. We don't know exactly where it was, but according to Mark 9, Jesus took Peter, James, and John and led them up into a high mountain. Some believe it to be Mount Hermon, which rose 9,000 feet above sea level. There the Bible records that Jesus was transfigured before them, his garments shining with a heavenly brightness. His glory was revealed now in a more personal way, denoting his royal presence, for the kingdom of God is in the midst of his people. I have a note that I wrote in my Bible at some stage, and it says this: he shone because he is God, not because he was in God's presence. He shone because he is God.
Amen.
Moses and Elijah appeared talking with him. Now, if you remember, Moses had a vision of God's glory on Mount Sinai. Elijah also had a vision on Mount Horeb. And here they were, these two, in the presence of Jesus, the Son of God, with him. The Transfiguration was important because it looks back to the Old Testament with those two that Christ fulfilled, and forward to his crucifixion, his resurrection, and his ascension. And then we look at Revelation 14. Then I looked, and behold, a Lamb standing on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his Father's name written on their foreheads. And I heard a voice from heaven, as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of a great thunder. And I heard the voice of harpers harping with their harps. And they sang, as it were, a new song before the throne, and before the four beasts and the elders. And no man could learn that song but the 144,000 which were redeemed from the earth. What a magnificent sight that will be. And as born again children of God, we shall see that Mount Zion. John says in Revelation 21:10, and he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain, and showed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God. Hebrews 12, but you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and church of the firstborn, which are written in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel. And the reason that we'll be there? Because Jesus, the only begotten Son of God, died on the cross for you and for me, and rose again, guaranteeing that we also will live together with him. Praise his wonderful name. As I threw over those mountains outside Cape Town and saw those valleys in between, I realized and thought about the fact that there are valleys that we go through. And at those times, what do? We have to lift up our eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh our help. Our help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Praise his wonderful name. I found a little verse written by Mildred N. Hoyer, and this is what she wrote. The day I climbed the mountain of Eden, I found the peace of mind I seek. Up there the big things looked so small, and the little things were not at all. The day I climbed the mountain of Eden, I found the peace of mind I seek. Up there the big things looked so small, and the little things were not at all. To us, sometimes the little things are so huge. When you look at it from God's perspective, you realize it's a small thing. So I go back to Psalm 125. They that trust in the Lord shall be as Mount Zion. Do you trust in the Lord? Be as Mount Zion, which cannot be removed, but abideth forever. It's strong, it's permanent. And if we rooted, grounded in the Lord Jesus Christ, we are firm. Nothing can shake us. Nothing at all. As the mountains are round about Jerusalem, so the Lord is round about his people from henceforth, forever. And I wrote a little note there at some stage. We are surrounded by God, by his marvelous, sweet presence, covered by his feathers, surrounded by his promises. Isn't that wonderful?
Amen.
Surrounded by God, by his marvelous, sweet presence, covered by his feathers, surrounded by his promises.
Amen.
Trust in the Lord. Stand firm. Be grounded. No matter what we may see or hear, it's by his prayer. Lord, we thank you for the mountains. And we thank you too, Lord, that we have mountains in our lives, mountains that seem insurmountable. But Lord, you are God. Lord, you too, you take us through the valleys, and you bring us up into the mountains and to the hills, where we rejoice with you. You're the God of the mountain, but you're also the God of the valleys.
Amen.
And we thank you, Lord, that you're unchangeable, that you're permanent, that you are trustworthy, that no matter what we may face today or any day ahead, Lord, that you're our strength, our Redeemer. You're the one who brings us over the mountains, and you enable us, Lord, to look down to see those insignificant things that we thought were so big. Lord, I pray for each one this morning that no matter what we all face, that you will be with them, that you will care for each one, that your blessing shall rest upon it all. And thank you for your word. Thank you for what we've shared this morning. Pray for a continued blessing now, Lord, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Bless you, thank you. We're going to close with bind us together, Lord. Yes.
You're battling, are you?
Yes, I am.
Heavenly Father, we take authority over this cough and the cause of it in Annie's body. Rebuke it now in the name of Jesus, that you bring healing and deliverance, that you'd be able to breathe normally and no further effect of this cough.
Thank you, Lord.
Lord, for us at you, and pray for him. Lord, that you'd have mercy upon
Jesus.
You'd have mercy upon your child. Have mercy upon him. Deliver him. Jesus.
Thank you.
Bind us together. bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In Jesus' mighty name as you go.
Amen.
Bind us together.